So what does God look like? I mean, how would you recognize God if or when God were to show up? Artists have attempted to depict God's image in countless ways all throughout the millennium. Centuries before Jesus' birth, ancient prophets spoke of the coming of a Messiah, a deliverer. They said this person would be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Well, what does the Wonderful Counselor look like? How would you describe the appearance of a Prince of Peace, whose government will be on his shoulders, and that government will have no end? I mean, expectations of the Messiah would be in, and what they would be like and what they would look like had been in existence for centuries prior to Jesus. Some said that this person would be a worldly political revolutionary who would restore the glory days of Israel when David was king. Others visualized a Messiah who would represent the Greek ideal of being wise, philosophically sound. But you know, if you really want to find what a person's portrait of God looks like, all we have to do is sort of ask ourselves, what kind of God do you and I pray? Do you think of God as one who has watched everything that you've done, morning, noon, night, set around making records of everything that you said, did, didn't do, didn't say, and is going to judge you? Maybe as a loving parent, but would that God in judging you be merciful? Do you picture a God who's concerned basically with saving people just for life after death? Or one who's actively engaged in restoring and renewing the lives of persons who live in horrible, devastated places? Do you believe that God always rewards thus a good obedience, good behavior, with wealth, with health, or that God remains present with us in poverty and pain, suffering? What does God look like? Listening to the children's sermon this morning sort of takes me back decades of time when I think the portrait that I would have had of God looked a lot like Santa Claus. I mean, the one that you saw with a Coke in his hand, rosy cheeks, glim, you know, a glow in his eyes. A God who would just fulfill little Jimmy's notion of a prosperity gospel. I've created God as a Santa Claus who would just promise to fulfill all my earthly wants, and all I had to do was just write a little letter, stick it out in the mailbox. My father would probably pick it up, make sure it got hand delivered. Sometimes the way we think about God is just better expressed in a song, and you can help me do it. This God who knows everything that we do, he sees you when you're sleeping. He knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good. So be good for goodness sake. Yeah. So you better watch out. Is that our portrait of God? Who just meets out these kinds of rewards according to our behavior? If so, that's not the God we meet when we sort of edge up to the cradle itself, or rather the feeding trough, and sort of peer over into it. What we encounter in this Jesus. You know, that effort that you and I put into making Christmas magical. The joy that we hope to maybe even rekindle in ourselves. Our children sort of help us do that. And I think it's not without intention and purpose that God has offered us an annual representation of the approach that we can take to life through the affection we bring to this wee small child. It seems as if God has taken our hopes and our dreams and placed them on a bed of straw, humble conditions and situation, so that no one has an excuse for being excluded. Everyone is welcome to come and peer over into the eyes of this small child. And through this small child and those of us who take on his life of discipleship, God has chosen to repair this world through our discipleship, to set about fixing everything that's broken. You and I will stress ourselves a bit about creating warm and fuzzy feelings for our families and ourselves. And I can remember as a child, all of the energy and the excitement was really leading up to Christmas. It wasn't so much Christmas Day itself, but it was 3 days out, and then 2 days out. And Christmas Eve, I was coming out of my skin. I don't know how my parents managed to control the kind of energy I could generate in those 24, 48 hours. But Christmas Day itself, after I had ripped open all of the presents, and there they were, lying on the floor, just waiting for me to pick each one up and bless it. We're playing with it, or sharing it with a friend. By the end of the day, as the sun began to set, I'd sort of hold my forehead like this and think, oh, gosh, it's 365 more days until I get to do this again. So how over this next year of time am I going to prepare for this Christmas miracle again? Because it is a celebration of a miracle. And a miracle in biblical terms isn't magic. Magic is illusion. Miracle in the biblical world is a work of power. And Luke wants you to know. Matthew wants you to know. Jesus wants you to know that because you're made in God's image, and what I'm looking at in this congregation is 150 self-portraits of God. Oh, you come as men, you come as women, blondes, brunettes, bald, you come as semi-blind. You come in different languages and in skin colors. And it's just remarkable that God has taken each one of us and given us a Christmas present by placing it in your heart. It's some conviction. It's something that God wants to change in the world, and in order to do it, you have to become one of the main actors on the stage in your discipleship. Whatever God wants done begins as a conviction in your heart. And there, as you care for it, you'll gain clarity of vision. And then you'll be able to deliver to the world God's intention and purpose through you. God gives birth to miracles through ordinary people. Jesus was an ordinary person. I mean, really, if you're honest with this, so ordinary that the majority of the people in his day wouldn't even say he was the Messiah. There was a handful, a baker's dozen or so. At one point, it was estimated that in Jesus' time and in his ministry, he may have had as many as 150 faithful followers. now they're in the millions. Because God uses ordinary people to bring about and to do God's work in this world. How biblical is the Christmas that you and I share? Growing up as a child, I have to admit, primary focus for me was that elf that lived in the North Pole. Had that Coke bottle in his hand. And as a child, I set out a bottle of Coke and a slice of fruit cake. I mean, am I the only one here who still likes fruit cake? And every Christmas day I would awaken to the Coke being empty and the fruit cake being gone. You know, I'm 71 years old, and to this day, when I go home Christmas Eve, I sit in a dark room with only the Christmas tree lit, and I eat a piece of fruit cake. And I drink a Coke. It's in a can now. You can still get the bottles, but somehow or another, my Christmas is incomplete without that tradition of fruitcake and that Coke, because my ideas, in a sense, that were so formative about Christmas weren't so much the nativity scene that my mother would labor over and put out and had every animal on the planet there, including some that just weren't even on that continent. It was based on old Saint Nick, 18th century Victorian practices added a double dose of Christmas theology to me, Santa theology. The night before Christmas was the real Christmas. But let's not forget, if we go to the real story itself, it wasn't always met with such joy. There was a genocide that occurred. Some believe that if this Messiah were to really be born among us, it'd be a power change. Herod's response to it wasn't, "Oh, I'm just jazzed that the Messiah has come. And in my lifetime, too, I'm just overjoyed. Matter of fact, you go find that child for me, you three wise people, that I may come and pay my homage. I'm jazzed about this." And when those three, or however many magi there were, didn't return with that information to Herod, he got so upset he ordered the massacre of every child who was 2 years old and younger. Sometimes that's the response the world makes to what God's trying to do to heal all the broken places. Sometimes it's not met with acceptance and joy and appreciation, gratification, hopes realized. Sometimes it's met with not here, not now. It's met with violence. Way back then, and even now, the Christmas story for all of us isn't found in personal comforts, material luxuries. It's not found in spending and eating and stress. Maybe it's found in sort of the sacrificial giving that you and I do. When we think about parents who come just to celebrate just the blessing of an ordinary life, a son or a daughter, filled with such hope and promise, only to be told by the doctors of a hospital that we need to keep a close eye on your child for the next 2 weeks, 6 weeks. And you can come and visit, and you can put your arms through two open holes that we have in this neonatal unit, and you can touch that child because it needs to be touched. And then weeks will pass and it'll graduate to where you can take it out of that sort of incubation. You can hold it in your arms and feed it, and you're yearning for the day when you can take that child home. But the parents are filled with worry, concern. And you lighten their burden because of your own discipleship and the living out of the conviction in your hearts that whereas you can't take away all of the things that happen to us in this life, you can be present in the context. You can be there with something that may bring that distressed set of parents comfort, hope, presence. Every miracle that God works is conceived in the heart of some believer. It grows in conviction and clarity there, and then it's delivered through your committed actions that have to end up changing or transforming the lives of someone, someone's, somewhere. The angel Gabriel once said to Mary, "You'll have a child, and you'll give birth." And how many days or months did it take for her to get that picture clarified in her mind of how she was going to be at 12, 13, 14 years old, a mother to such a child? And to get her from that announcement to the place where she would actually give birth, God had planted and needed to plant seeds of the miracle in her heart and in Joseph's, until together they were willing to act on God's vision. Every spirit-filled Christian has the potential for a God movement within her or him. The miracle is conceived and delivered through ordinary people who are willing to dream God's dreams and then act on God's vision. And you know, one of the things that blesses Christianity more than anything else on this planet, it's not the affirmation of faith we say. It's not the hymns that we sing at Christmas and Easter. It's the portrait people have of God and seeing God only through their eyes that are perceiving you and me as being a Christian. Are you tender and loving and merciful and compassionate and caring? Do you give health? Do you feed the hungry? Do you care for those who are homeless? Do you fret over those who've left home and country and come to a place where they hope things will be better? To either enable that hope and its expression or to stop it in its tracks? Are you ready to give birth to the Christmas miracle that God is working in you? The world is watching, and your response and reaction will be the portrait they see. In the name of the Father, Son, and